Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum, dear students, and welcome to office.com.pk. This is your own platform where you come and learn, and we provide you with short and handy information that is useful for you and that is easy to memorize. We try our level best to make your syllabus easier for you as much as possible. Dear students, this is your biology class and we have been discussing chapter number 20th, that is about DNA and chromosomes. And in the previous lecture, we have discussed the different theories that are associated with chromosomal inheritance. And we have seen that how chromosomal theory was put forward and how it was proved right to explain the role of chromosomes as hereditary bodies that are present within the individuals. Today we are going to start another topic that is very important, and it is DNA as hereditary material. We'll see about the hereditary nature of DNA, who observed it, who experimented on it, and then who proved it. So, without wasting time, let us begin. My dear students, the initial evidences or the initial information related to DNA as hereditary material was provided by a British microbiologist. Microbiologists are those who are studying microbiology or the life of microorganisms and their impact on other living organisms. So he was a British microbiologist and his name was Frederick Griffith. Actually, he was performing some experiments with the bacteria Streptococcus pneumoniae. This bacteria is responsible for causing pneumonia in human beings as well as in animals. So, this scientist was working on this bacteria. And he made some observations during his experiments, because my dear students, when certain experiments they are performed, so in addition to our actual intentions, we also make some other observations and they are recorded, and then different theories are developed depending upon that particular observation. So he was performing experiment with Streptococcus pneumoniae, also this is known as pneumococcus bacteria. So he took the virulent strain of this bacteria. Virulent, by virulent we mean the infection causing bacteria, or the virulent strain means a strain that has the ability to cause a disease. It still retains its ability to cause the disease in the individuals. So what he did was, he infected mice using these Streptococcus pneumoniae bacteria, and the result was death of mice due to blood poisoning. So this is obvious. If you infect an organism with a disease causing bacteria, or the bacteria which has the ability to cause a disease, then obviously that individual is going to die. On the other hand, when he infected mice once again, with the muted strains of same bacteria, with no virulent activity, no virulence, means this bacteria lacked the ability to cause a disease. So he observed the mutant. It was mutant because its polysaccharide coat was removed. So when mice were infected using this bacteria with no virulence and with their polysaccharide coat removed, the mice, they showed no ill effects. Or you can say the mice, they showed no signs of the disease or blood poisoning. Obviously, when you are infecting the mice with the strain which lacks the ability of virulence, ultimately it will not cause any disease. So he made a conclusion that probably the coat was necessary for causing the disease or causing the virulence. The normal pathogenic forms of this bacteria are known as S type because they form the smooth colonies, and the mutant strain with the polysaccharide coat removed is known as R type because it forms the rough colonies. Now we'll see that in order to determine whether the polysaccharide coat was actually important for causing the virulence and disease, he performed another series of experiments. Now we will see those experiments.